Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
The Essentials of Persuasive Public Speaking, written and read by Sims Wyeth. To my wife, Sharon, and my daughter, Georgie, and in memory of my parents, Nancy and Buzz Wyeth. Praise no man before he speaks, for it is then that men are tested. The Book of Sirach, chapter 27, verses 6 to 7. Introduction. On the day you ascend into heaven, take a few minutes to sit on a cloud and add up the hours you spent giving presentations or speaking publicly. The total will be a small fraction of your time on earth. However, those few occasions may well have had a disproportionate impact on your professional success, and quite possibly on the fullness of your life. Why is this? Because unless you're a famous artist, you give more to others through your speech than through any other form of communication, because you know more than you can say, but you can say more than you can write. And if you're a knowledge worker, somebody who makes a living with words and numbers, your career depends on how you speak, write, and think, in that order, because nobody knows what you think until you speak or write. And these days, few of us read. We skim, we scan, we surf, but mostly we wait for the meeting. We wait for the presentation, when a speaker turns information into meaning and imprints that meaning on our minds through the power of story. This audio program contains short pointers on presenting and public speaking. You can consume them randomly, serially, or topically. They come out of my fascination with speech, my respect for those who do it well, and my own ambition to be confident, persuasive, and engaging. I've tried to make all the pointers substantive and fun, like organic potato chips, so you'll consume them one after the other. Most of them tell you what to do or not to do when preparing and delivering speeches or presentations. However, occasionally a pointer escapes from the realm of the practical and lights out for the territory of the general and the abstract. But I've tried to keep the number of runaways to a minimum. Public speaking is a centripetal social force. It pulls people into the same place at the same time to think about the same thing. It is an ancient technology designed to help tribes, communities, companies, and nations make wise decisions. Good leaders generally speak well, but not all good speakers are good leaders. Demagogues, despots, and egotists abound. The world needs you to be a good leader who speaks well and a good advisor to leaders. I hope my pointers are helpful. The power of speech. Suspend their disbelief. When I was a child in Katona, New York, I had a recurring dream that I stood atop the Cross River Dam and said powerful and eloquent things to people off in the distance. The dream foretold my future. I became an actor and spoke the poetry of Shakespeare before becoming a professor of theater and then a consultant to business leaders. Theater and business have something in common. In both, you get paid for your performance, and those who get paid the most are endowed, or acquire through study and experience, the ability to create in others the willing suspension of disbelief. That, in a nutshell, is the job of the actor and of the business speaker. Make it personal. Like many young people who value authenticity and watch their pennies, my 28-year-old daughter does not buy greeting cards. She makes her own. I have quite a collection of them, including this from a recent Christmas. Your spirit outweighs your burden. 100 calls. Each old day, fresh hands. I have it taped to the wall in my office for inspiration when I'm cold calling. Hallmark, makes good cards, but I've never put one on my wall. Speech that authentically reveals the personality of the speaker and is addressed to and about an individual or defined group is far more memorable than a message from a corporation meant for a demographic. Make all your presentations personal. Let there be drama. Marcus Tullius Cicero, the great Roman orator, said, "Tickling and soothing anxieties is the test of a speaker's impact and technique." He could have said the same about dramatists and storytellers. We humans come together over drama. In the past, we gathered to hear stories around the fire, sagas of gods sung on a lyre, and the tragedies of great men with fatal flaws. We're still doing it. We gather to watch plays, movies, and TV shows. We gather by the millions to watch sporting events because the outcome is uncertain, and we stay up late to see what happens next. A speaker should be a dramatist capable of capturing and holding attention by tickling and then soothing audience anxiety. Let there be drama in your presentations. Fake it till you make it. When I ask people to try a more expressive style, to be louder or to get their hands above their waist, I often hear them say, "That's not my style," or "That's just not me." Limiting your definition of self must be comforting, but sometimes, as a speaker, you need to act not as you would habitually, but as you must to achieve your goals. In other words, you need to fake it till you make it. Actors rehearse until they discover and become the character. You can practice new behaviors until they become more natural. You may have fixed traits, but to grow as a speaker, you should sign a free trait agreement with yourself. How about some wisdom? I am tired of expert speakers with expert opinions. Everyone is an expert in something. I want a wise speaker. I liked it when Peter Gomes, the minister at Harvard, said at a graduation ceremony, "There is less going on here than meets the eye." And I was lit up for days after I read this Einstein quote inscribed over a bar, "There are two ways to live. You can live as if there is no such thing as a miracle, or you can live as if everything is a miracle." We put our trust in experts, and they're often proved wrong. Enough already with the experts. How about some wisdom? Spoken beats written. Written words are the children of absent fathers. Their dads aren't around to help them explain themselves. Socrates complained about this problem. If you question written words, wanting to know about their sayings, they always say only one and the same thing. Consider what questioning could have done for these headlines. "Red tape holds up new bridge, Milford, Connecticut, citizen, July 12, 1982. Defendant's speech ends in long sentence, Minneapolis Tribune, February 25, 1987. Panda lectures this week at National Zoo. The Washington Post, January 13, 2001. Spoken language is less ambiguous and more persuasive than written language because it is amplified and clarified by gesture, voice, character, and dialogue. A Zen monk had sweaty palms. A Zen monk, always calm among commoners, noticed he had sweaty palms while officiating at a nobleman's wedding. He returned to his monastery, told his disciples he was not fit to be their teacher, and left in search of enlightenment. 8 years later, he returned to resume his duties, serving with equanimity commoners and noblemen alike. Your sameness of bearing in front of chairman and workman demonstrates your ability to speak to the sameness of being in all your listeners. Tone it down. In the 23 years I've been working with business speakers, I've had only one client to whom I had to say, "You've got to tone it down." Passion is great, but not when it lacks decorum, not when it offends the tone of the occasion and distracts the audience from the message. It was relatively easy for him to tone it down. Cutting back is easier than taking it up a notch. Public speaking is the glue. Public speaking is the number one tool of leadership because when you get people in a room to hear the same message at the same time, you have the greatest chance of moving them to action. Don't waste your opportunities. The glue that holds people together is a magical mystery sauce of trust, emotion, and shared purpose. In business, meetings and presentations are key opportunities for creating and sustaining that magic. Why do we present? Why don't we just hand in our report and call it a day? Because we humans have been around in our present form for 200,000 years. If we envision those years along a yardstick, written language appears on the last two-thirds of the final inch of that stick, and widespread literacy on the last 16th of the final inch. For 200,000 years, human groups have made important decisions based on the spoken word, testing not only the ideas under discussion, but the character of those who propose them. If you can move the minds of others, they see in you the ability to get things done, and they see that in your language and expression. Be logical and stylish. The best book I know about business presenting is Moving Mountains by Henry M. Bottinger, published by Macmillan in 1969. Here are some quotes from the book. "Cool, clinical men may analyze an idea until it lies dead in their hands like a dissected frog. But even Hegel, that most academic of philosophers, acknowledged nothing great has been accomplished without passion. Logic may be the language of reason, but style adds to it life, sentiment, shading, and judgment. Training teaches the rules. Experience teaches the exceptions. If you're a serious student of the art, find this book." Aspire to wear the crown. As an audience grows in size, both the inhibition of the intellect and the intensification of emotions grow roughly in proportion. But in smaller groups, dialogue and detail become more important. Most of us in business are better at talking about facts and figures than we are at evoking emotions, values, and beliefs. But the ability to unite both types of speaking, the intellectual and the emotional, is the jewel in the crown of public speech.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.